It is an archaic meaning, okay, to harm or attack repeatedly. So when anger, part of the definition of anger is, we get angry because we are repeatedly being harassed or tormented by the enemy. It's one thing after another, after another, after another, after another, and it just works on us and works on us, and we begin to lose our cool, and then we turn to whatever. Some people turn to Bluebell ice cream. Some people just, you know, get up, move. Some people have to go get their nails done. Some people, you know, whatever your vice is, minus sarcasm. Okay? Sarcasm. If I don't say it out loud, I guarantee you I'm going off in my head. If I'm looking at you like, really, for Rizzle? Okay, I'm being sarcastic in my mind. Now, what am I doing in front of you? Hallelujah. Yes, yes, Lord Jesus. Thank you. Am I being transparent? Is this okay? All right, so it's a repeated, continual attack. The word irritation means to annoy. Annoyed to the point of getting someone angry, or you know, to continue to push and not relent. So I want you to notice the repeat. These are repeated attacks. Be ye angry and sin not. Why? Okay, look at the next verse. Neither give place to the devil. So the repeated annoyances. Things aren't going right. Things aren't working right. What used to be easy going is now difficult. You know, it used to be easy to get out of bed. Am I talking to anybody? Not anymore. It's like a baby giraffe just being born. You just waiting to make sure you can take that first step. And then hallelujah time if you make it to the bathroom. Am I talking to anybody? Just sometimes, you know, remember you used to be able to go to a restaurant, eat your favorite food? Not anymore. Now your stomach says, oh, attention mouth, we've got issues. Even though your taste buds really desire this, you know we can't handle this in our department here in the basement. Am I talking to anybody? So no matter what you do, it's a continual, repeated harassment. Are they world-changing events? No. Is it going to change the price of eggs in China? No. Is it going to stop nuclear war? No. Okay? But what happens is when you're going through this season, the enemy, the devil, is trying to find a place where he can come in. And so it's one thing after another, after another, after another, after another. And we start asking God, God, why is this going on? When are we going to get a break? What's up with this? Hello? Am I talking to anybody? Hello, hello, God, God, where are you? Remember me. And so it says here, neither give place for the devil. And so we see here, the devil uses these to gain advantage over us. Neither give place to the devil. And so this repeated attack, okay, leads to something that's called frustration. Now frustration is where the enemy is endeavoring to build up a stronghold. Let me give you another definition. Frustration is, the definition of frustration, believe it or not, is to prevent a plan or action from progressing or succeeding. What that means is, in the realm of the spirit, God has set in motion a plan to promote you, to get you a breakthrough, to bring that blessing, to answer that prayer. And the devil said, nah, we can't just let that go on smoothly. We need to devise a counter strategy so we can hinder. And so what he's trying to do, he's trying to frustrate us concerning the plans of God. Because according to the definition of frustration, it's to prevent you, it's to stop you from receiving whatever you were on the edge of about to receive. Whether it's a healing in your body, whether it's a breakthrough, whether it's a family member, whether it's finances, the enemy says, no, we're not going to make it that easy. And he sets up these little skirmishes to come your way. You go out there, put your car keys in, car don't start. It's always starting. You go out to the parking lot, you can't find your car. But I've associated that with age too. Thank God for the key fobs where you can just beep, beep. Oh yeah, that's me. Am I talking about anything? So he sets up these series of events in order to prevent what's going on. Now, I don't know about you, when these series of events going on, I'm not thinking, oh, hallelujah, it's promotion time, yay. You can ring my bell, ring my bell, promotion time. No, that's not what you're thinking. You're getting mad. You're getting upset. You're getting annoyed and irritated. And so the devil shows up, not with a pitchfork, but with a highlighter. And what he does is he highlights everything in the negative. Am I talking to anybody? All right. So it's to prevent us from entering into the next season. And it's also defined to cause or to feel dissatisfied or unfulfilled. Now, you can't count your blessings. You can't look around and say, wow, look what God has done. You begin to look around and go, look what's falling apart. Look what's not happening. And so, like I said, the enemy shows up with some highlighters, and he begins to highlight things, and instead of seeing it as a blessing, as the truth that it is, you begin to find fault with it. You begin to become critical. Look at somebody and say, I've never done that, but maybe I have. So in essence, the satanic attacks are just when you are on the verge of some kind of breakthrough, and the devil says, no, it's not going to happen. You're waiting for finances. All of a sudden, a series of events. You're waiting for this event to take place, for your child, for whatever it is. And all of a sudden, this series of events begin to happen. What's the enemy trying to do? He's trying to frustrate the plan of God. In the book of Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26, the Message translation says it like this. Go ahead and be angry. You do well to be angry. But don't use your anger as fuel for revenge. Now, I don't know about you, well, let me not go there. Some of y'all can't handle that. Oh, my God. Who would put a hand grenade in somebody's mouth, pull the pin, and run away? So don't let it to fuel your revenge, and don't stay angry. Don't go to bed angry, okay? Don't give the devil that kind of foothold in your life. So when these series of events, these annoyances and these hindrances leads to this frustration, what's going on? The devil's trying to get a foothold into your life. He's trying to get in there somehow. He wants you to focus on everything that's going wrong and instead of the blessing that's on the horizon. Look at somebody and say, you're about to be blessed. So, usually when we go through things and things become very frustrating, what's the first thing we like to do? I don't know about you, I like to complain. Is complaining biblical? It's very dangerous. We should not complain. What do we do anyways? We complain. Because we feel justified. I shouldn't be going through this kind of stuff because I'm a Christian. I serve Jehovah God. Am I talking about it? So the enemy goes, bing, 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 bing. He takes these little crack shots. And you're thinking, now I don't know about you. I need to know why I'm going through what I'm going through. I have to have an understanding. What is going on, Lord? What's going on? Why? And I didn't bother asking the Lord until just the other night. That's how smart I was during my time of frustration. Now I know you're, you know, academic geniuses, but let me just continue on. So the devil will try to use these tactics, okay, to frustrate you, so we will give in to sin. Neither give place to the devil, because he wants us to sin. What is the number one sin amongst believers that they don't think is a sin? It's complaining. Go with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 10. 1 Corinthians 10, 10. We feel justified if we complain. 1 Corinthians 10, 10. Is that New Testament? It says, neither murmur ye. The word murmur is complain, grumble, fuss, cuss. Now some of us are professional cussers. You know who you are. All of a sudden, halos appeared all over sanctuary. Bing, bing, bing. I say, Paul, I'm glad this message is not about me. Neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured, and were destroyed of the destroyer. So griping, complaining gives the devil legal access to God's people. That's what happened to the children of Israel. As they were walking to the promised land, as they were going to their destination, they griped and complained. The Bible says in the book of Deuteronomy, it should have been an 8-day journey. 8 days from this place to this. 8 is symbolic of new beginnings. So God was saying in another language that in Bible code, he said, I'm going to take you out of Egypt. I'm going to take you to the promised land. It's only going to take 8 days. 8 is symbolic of complaining. They were there for 40 years. Why? They didn't know how to keep their mouth shut. I'm tired. I'm hot. I'm tired of this. I'm tired of that. I want meat. I don't want meat. I'm water. I'm thirsty. Now their needs were being met. Every day over 1 million people were supernaturally supplied for. Their shoes grew with them. Everybody was in style. Hey, those same shoes you wore 10 years ago? Yes, they are. Hey, I'm style and profile. They haven't broke yet. How do you like it? Woo. Their clothes grew with them. There was not one sniffle, not one sickness in the camp. Not one. I'm not happy. When are we going to get there? And I don't like Pastor Moses. Moses is getting mama nerves. He thinks he can just boss people around, man of God, an hour and a power, and always comes down with these commandments trying to tell me what to do, blah, blah. It was better when I was in the world. At least I had, cucumbers and watermelon, and, forget that they took my children and they were beaten and my wife was sold into a sex slave. Forget all that stuff. At least it was, are you getting it? 40 years. They could have been there in 8 days. Turned into a 40-year. And so what happened? A lot of them died in the wilderness. Why? Because they murmured and it opened the door. Complaining opens the door for the enemy to come in. So what we see here, when we get to the point of frustration and we begin to verbalize our frustration, the devil goes, hello, kingdom of darkness is working. Bring it on. And it begins to become more and more worse and more intense. Can anybody relate to this? Okay, now, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 1, it tells us where we do our complaining. Deuteronomy 1, verse 26, New Living Translation. But you rebelled against the command of the Lord, okay, your God, and refused to go in, talking about doing what God had said, okay. You complained in your tents. Where did they complain? In tents. Now, we wouldn't come to church and go, I don't have a testimony today. I have an issue with God. I'd like to go out and just declare my issue. They complained in their tents. That means when they got home, behind closed doors, as they're laying in bed with their honey, they got the sheet up going, did you see Sister So-and-so? Oh, my God. I just don't like the way Pastor Moses is doing that. Don't you get tired of all this manna? Manna this, manna this, manna, 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 manna. Now, they weren't starving. They had the most healthiest diet on the planet. There's not one sick amongst them. But anytime they got, the sun went down, they got behind closed doors, that's when the complaints start. Isn't that when you and I start? I had 3 people say, thank you, 3 people. The rest of you heathens, I'll be praying for you after service. Oh my God, I've never done that because I'm a Christian. I'll say, okay, all right, well, let's go a little further now. So they were complaining, fussing and cussing and griping in their tents. Now, everywhere you look, the enemy brings a highlight. And he's going to try to highlight things in the negative instead of in the positive. Can I be very, very transparent with you? While we were going through this incident, and still going through this incident with Pastor Karen, there was a series of events that the enemy began to highlight. And I'm going to just show you the good side and then the frustration side. The truth of the matter and what the enemy highlights in order to frustrate us. Let me start with just something simple, insurance. Now, insurance, Pastor Karen, since the beginning of January, can I be real personal? Since the beginning of, because you guys don't have these kind of problems, but we do. So since the beginning of January, she's been trying to get insurance, wrestling with the government because, Obamacare. And so wrestling with the government, no, back and forth. Talk to four people, yes, you've got it. Why can't you guys get this thing together? No, we can't have anything. Then she ended up in the hospital, no insurance. Turned out, talking to four different people, started four different policies, never got processed through. Now, the good news is that they backdated it and everything's covered. The bad news is, now this is where my sarcasm kicks in, is go, what kind of monkeys do they have working, pushing those buttons at that place? Why can't they get their act together? My God, these people are working for the government. No wonder we have a bunch of simians in charge making decisions. They can't even get their act together and they think we're the problem? Now that was one issue. And so what does the enemy do? He highlights at that. Now, the truth was, they backdated it, and it's taken care of. That's the truth, okay? So now, the next step is, we've got to seek approval. It's a $100,000 treatment, okay? It'll last several months, minor side effects. So it's a work in progress. The second thing, while Pastor Karen was in the hospital, is our spiritual parents, they sent her some flowers. Now, beautiful little thing of flowers and so forth, and we're thinking, hallelujah, and I thought, oh, isn't that lovely? But the devil brought out the highlight. And he said, nobody else sent flowers. Nobody else sent balloons or a card or anything else. But the truth of the matter was that our spiritual parents were kind enough to remember that to send some flowers. If you can't make a visit or if they're asking you for whatever, send some flowers, send some balloons, do something. But that's not what the enemy was doing. The enemy was going, see this? Nobody else. And it wasn't nobody else, it was nobody else. Are you getting this? And he highlights that. So what does that do? That annoys you and that frustrates you. Now, the next thing that happened is we're at home, and I'm having to take care of, I get to take care of my honey, and for some reason, we let the dogs out, they come in, and they stink to high heaven. I mean, oh, high heaven, we have Pekingese. And so Pekingese, you know how most animals, when they go to the bathroom, they have that shaved rear end? Ours do not. They have these fuzzy, bushy rear ends, and they go outside and they find either something dead or some kitty snacks that the cat left in the yard or something, and they're just eating it. Ha! Isn't this great? Yes! I don't feel so good. Neither do I. Now, because their rear ends are not shaved and smooth, whatever comes out of that posterior end gets caught in their hair. And so they come to the door, we let them in, they're all wagon happy, hey, glad you're home, how's everybody doing? Oh. And there's fog. So I had to give them a bath. Now I'm not happy because I have to give them a bath. Now, the truth is, we love our pets. They're like kids to us. How wonderful, covering the identity. What is wrong with you, going after? Don't you know any better? No, they don't. They're dogs. I cannot figure out why people buy their pets water purification systems when they lick their butts. That doesn't make sense. Now, they didn't do this just once. Who'll get it too? Yeah, you got it too. What? Oh, God. Three times. The last time I just put them in the bathtub, filled up the tub up to their necks, and I said, stay here. But they're wonderful pets. And so what was going on? The devil just brought some annoyances, okay? Here's another thing. Is this too transparent? You know, I've told the church for years, Mondays is our day off. Unless you have an emergency, you're dying, or you shot your finger off with a shotgun, don't call. Monday's my time with my honey. Not to some people, because it always starts out like this. I know it's Monday, and it's your day off. So one sister She said, you know, I'm having a problem, blah, blah, blah. I was interested in the freezer and the refrigerator, and so-and-so did this, and then I tried to call so-and-so, and so-and-so wasn't kind to me, and this and that. And we're driving home from the doctor, just hearing the doctor's report, and it is at that moment that the enemy chose to bring that text onto my phone to add more to my plate. Not, you know, how are you doing, Pastor John? Is Pastor Karen feeling okay? Can I bring over some lunch? Is there anything I can do for you? No, I'm upset. I'm disgruntled. I wanted this thing. I did this. I'm hoping you were stupid and believe my lie. I'm sorry, this was the truth side. Now, that could have been done any time, but it had to be during the middle of what we're going through. Then I get another text that day. Hi, I know, Pastor John, this is your day off, but I've had a situation happen. It happened quite a while back, but since you're going through this today, I figured that today, on Monday, on your day off, while knowing that your wife almost died on you, I figured today is the day that I would dump on you. And I'm not happy. And they said this, and I was, and I'm thinking, really? Stinking devil. Like we don't have more to deal with. Are you getting in here? Okay, so what's the enemy trying to do? Systematically attack. And so I thought, well, let me just go ahead and go to church. So I come to church. Now, here's the truth. We have a beautiful church building. God's blessed us. This building's paid off. We own 2/3 of a city block. We're reaching, you know, and into nations that other nations haven't touched. We're on, you know, YouTube. We've got, you know, all this stuff going on. Wonderful thing. I walk into the church, and what do I see? Why can't I get these adults to clean their offices? Now, the truth is, thank God I've got people to help us. That's the truth. Thank God for them. What did I see? I've been telling these people since January, clean your office. People are coming on Sunday. Clean your office. Thank God they're helping. So I go into the kitchen. Oh my God. It looks like a Chinese laundry in here. There's towels drying everywhere, and the dishes, and I've had meeting after meeting after meeting. Put up the dishes. Your mama does not live here. We've got people coming. This is bad in first impression. The truth is, we've got wonderful people serving God, fellowshipping, cooking, cleaning, taking their time out of their personal lives to minister. Thank you, Jesus. But Satan's highlighter. Are you getting it? You can't count your blessings while the enemy's trying to bombard you. I'm going to the fellowship hall. Now, I don't know about you, in the fellowship hall, I've noticed since the beginning of the year, there's been a stain. Right there in that front. Now, to you, it's a stain. You may have never noticed it. It's a stain. To me, it was, there's a stain by the front door. Are you getting in? Do you see that stain that's by the front door? It's a stain. Thank God we got a carpet to have a stain on. Hallelujah. But that highlighter, oh my God. Look at this stain, 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 stain. Why doesn't anybody else but me notice it on this planet, planet, planet? And I only have one eye and I can see it. Are you getting this? What is it? A systematic attack to try to frustrate you, to hinder you. Here's what else has happened. Can I share a little bit more? Thank you, I'm going to. So while Pastor Karen's in STC, I have to park out here. Now I have to be careful with my feet. Diabetic issues. So I have to park there. I've got to walk that long hallway. If you've ever been to Scotland, that long hallway to STC. Now, doing that several times a day for a week, being with my honey and so forth, I developed a blood blister on the side of my foot. Now, having the kind of feet that I do, you know, with their diagnosis of diabetes is not good. So when Karen got out of the hospital, she noticed it, because I didn't. And so we decided to clean it and drain it, and everything was going good. It was nice and pink, healing up real quickly. Karen was taking care of it. We're putting antibiotics up. Not a problem. Until one night. One night, the dog comes up and starts sniffing my foot, so I shush it away. Now it's wrapped up. It's got gauze on it. It's got real sticky tape on it. It's wrapped up and stuff. Never had any problems with it. The dog sniffed it, shushed it away, woke up the next morning, and all the bandages are gone. Can't find the bandages. Don't know where the bandages are. They didn't come off my sleeve, because we pack it tight. Looked down at my foot, and it's chewed up and bloody. The dog got a hole. Put a hole in my foot. Now, I could hear my son's voice saying, Jason, he goes, your dog is more likely to attack you than my pit bull, ho, 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 ho. So in the middle of the night, my dog, hey, well, I wonder what this is. Oh, good, it's packed tight, must be sushi. And so now I've got to go to the doctors and go through this process again. Now, that's the one thing I don't want to do, because I don't want to, well, we need to shave the bone on your foot there, Mr. Pelizzari, because of this and that. But everything was fine until I had to walk that long hallway. And so now I've got a hole in my foot. Got to go see the doctors. Now, the doctors told me, you know, anytime you got a problem, you got an emergency, call us, we'll get you right in. So we call. Well, their definition of getting right in and what we think is getting right in means a week or three later. So I had to go about a week later. So I'm going to schedule sometime this week. So in the meantime, I had to get some antibiotics because we didn't want to turn, you know, pussy infected and then have my foot sawed off, because I would not be happy. So we have these continual assignments. Now, is this too personal?
Yes, sir.
Continual assignments, one after another after another. So Karen's laying in the hospital, and you know, Zach comes up to see her, and I thought, well, praise God, you know? Now, that's the good part. Now, what Satan highlights is no other family member came up to see you. Are you getting this? The good news is the other family members are doing well. They have their own families to take care of, and it's quite a drive. But that's not what the enemy highlights. Are you getting this? And so you've got this all going on, back and forth. So I thought, you know what? Karen's doing a little bit better. Let me go ahead, and she likes to garage sale. She likes to flea market. How many of you flea markets do we have? Garage sales. Woo, where's my people? All right. So we go out, and we go to this one place, and there's this black leather chair, and it's an office chair. It's comfortable, and I thought, wow, my butt would be good in this. So it's only $15. Praise God. Here you go. $15. I saved up some change. Take her. Okay, we're going. Load it up. Come home, take off the price tag, and right where they put the price tag, there's a big rip. Well, honey, we can fix it. I don't want it. I don't want the chair. Why? Because they ripped me off. Matter of fact, I'm going to go and find some cow manure, put it in a lunch bag, put it in their mailbox, and write a dirty note to it. Now, this is what I'm thinking, and I'm the pastor. I hate to see what you think. Because, you know, some of you go, ooh, you got that dark place. You and Lord Vader, join us. Does anybody see this? Now, are these life-threatening, life-changing? Are these major issues? Absolutely not. But when Satan brings his highlighter, you can't counter blessings. You can't say, hey, thank God we have this and this, and I appreciate you and what you do. No, it's like, what is wrong with you people? Am I talking to anybody? And so the enemy highlights that stuff in order to get you into that vicious cycle. Why? Because he's trying to find a place to do what? Because he wants to provoke us to sin. He's provoking us. It's like a bully trying to get you at the playground. Push me in the shoulder.
What you gonna do? Crybaby? What you gonna do? You gonna go take it off? What you gonna do? Come on, why don't you grow? Why don't you do something about it? Why don't you do something about it? What you gonna do?
I don't like you. And I don't know why my God's not taking care of me. And he could just wave his hand and all of y'all would just get poofed away.
Are you hearing what I'm saying? Go with me, if you will, to the book of Numbers, chapter 11. None of these things were world-changing events, okay? But they did lead to frustration, okay? Now, the devil uses frustration to make you feel, okay, that you are no longer in control. Are you getting this? And that you're at the mercy of your circumstances, okay? And what this does, it evokes feelings of uncertainty. Now you're not certain. Now you're not sure if God loves you. Now you're not sure if God is going to answer your prayers while you're going through this situation. Whatever your situation is. To me, it was this. And it was frustrating. I couldn't see the blessings. I couldn't count my blessings. I didn't want to talk blessings. As a matter of fact, I went into my old backslidden closet and I looked, let's see what I can pull out. Oh yeah, there's my sailor certificate. Let me put that, display that on the wall. Am I talking to anybody? And so you're going through this and the enemy's trying to provoke you. Let me show you something. The book of Numbers, chapter 11, verse 1. Soon the people began to complain about their hardship, and the Lord heard everything they said. Oh, great. I was happy when I found that scripture. Oh, you heard me. Well, I can explain. See, there was the foot, the flower, the doctor, the insurance, and this and that. And you're not buying it. Am I talking to anybody? Okay. And so it said, the Lord heard everything they said. Then the Lord's anger blazed against them. And he sent them a fire to rage amongst them and destroyed some of the people, okay, in the outskirts of the camp. Now, this is God's reaction. I'm thinking, okay, if you would have told me that, I would have bought a flamethrower. Hey, where's the dogs? Those pile right there. What about this? That's that pile right there. I've taken care of it. I've lived the word. I've demonstrated the Lord's anger. You got a problem with me, sister? Call me again. There you go. Put that in your freezer. Am I talking to anybody? You get relatives calling you. You get people at work. You get family members, and then your own brain turns against you. Now you're not happy about nothing. You could be in the middle of receiving a blessing and still miss the opportunity to be joyful. So God himself became frustrated, okay? But why did he become frustrated? He became frustrated, what it says right there, because they were complaining. Can you imagine God being frustrated? Because people are complaining. I must have frustrated them the past 2 weeks. Where are you? You're the healer. I don't see any healing. Matter of fact, I got a hole in my foot. Now holy man has a new meaning. Are you getting this? Why aren't you taking care of this? Now, I'm not normal like that. But it just started a cycle. Why? Because there was something beyond my control. I couldn't do anything to help my honey.
God bless you.
And it was frustrating. And then it seemed like everybody else wasn't really concerned about my honey the way I was concerned about my honey. They were concerned about their things. Does anybody see how the enemy highlights that stuff? And so you go through this, and the enemy begins to highlight that. Go with me to the book of Mark, chapter 3, verse 5. Now, the way I handled it, I became like Paul. I became an Indian. I had my own tribe because Paul says he became the chiefest of sinners. He was chief sinner. I put Paul to shame. Made him look like a kitten compared to this Wolverine. Because sometimes you just don't feel like walking in holiness.
Yeah.
Hey, what are you going to do today? Oh, I'm walking in righteousness. You got stuff going on? Yeah, but oh, say, oh. Is this too real, too transparent? Because some of you might be disappointed. Oh my God, he's one of us. He's been on this planet. Okay, let's go a little further. Mark chapter 3, verse 5. How should we handle it? Well, let's look at the Jesus, okay? Now, get that. It might be God telling you to turn it off in church services. So what's the key of relief? Mark chapter 3, verse 5, Message translation. Jesus looked at them in the eye. These are the religious folks. Now, Jesus is going around healing people, and on this day, it happens to be the Sabbath day, and the rules are, don't do any work on the Sabbath day, and the religious folks decided to translate that as, Jesus, you can't go around healing people on the Sabbath day. What is your major malfunction? If you were one of us, you would know that. And so notice Jesus' response as they're circling him while he's healing this man. He looked them in the eye, one after another. Can you imagine Jesus staring you down? Angry now. How's Jesus? Angry. Can you imagine the eyes of eternity looking into your very soul? Not with hallelujah. Angry. Angry now. And notice this. Furious at their hard-nosed religion. And he said to the man, what's he doing? He's ignoring the source of his frustration. He could have lashed out on him, but he didn't. Notice what he did. He said to the man, hold out your hand. And he held it out, and it was good as new. Jesus could have called fire from heaven, could have done anything, but he looked at the very ones who was making him mad, getting mad, looked, staring at him. I'd hate to have those eyes look at me like that, wouldn't you? Just looking at him, boy. So what did he do? Well, at that point, here's what I learned. I have a choice. I can either let the devil make me mad and provoke me to sin, or I can push back and make him mad by doing something good. Are you getting any of this? And so that's what Jesus did. Okay, devil, you raised up your crowd, I'll go ahead and raise up mine. And he healed the man. And the religious folks didn't like him. Well, how dare you? Who do you think you are? You know, Jesus, staring down the religious folks, okay, who are fussing because he's healing, he just decided to do the exact opposite. And the thing about it is, I've preached that for years. Do the opposite of what you feel. Not past 2 weeks. I want to get everybody peace of my mind. I'd stand in the front door. Hey, you want peace of my mind? Come here. Come get some. Go to Walmart. What you looking at? You don't want none of this today. I'm holy man. I'm loaded. Anybody ever just feel like waking up sometime? Today, I'm not going to be a Christian. Okay? So while he was angry, he chose to do good. God allows anger, but not the sin. So I'm going to give you some things that the Lord showed me. Would that be okay? Is it okay that I was transparent?
Yes.
Oh my God, I didn't know.
Shazbat, nanu.
Number one, give your brain a distraction. When the enemy's trying to frustrate you and you're going through a series of events and it seems like it's one thing after another, give your brain a distraction. The devil loves to put you in a cycle, okay, so that you can see no way out of the madness. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11, so that Satan will not outsmart us, for we are familiar with his evil plan. I hate to think that the devil outsmarted me. God, that bothers me. So what do you got to do? Well, when you're frustrated, The only thing you can focus us on is everything that's going wrong, what's not happening, and so-and-so did this, and so-and-so did that, and I'm going to become a serial killer. I've watched Dexter. I know how to use cellophane. I can just wrap them up in, you know, saran wrap and put them in the belt and bam. Am I talking to anybody, or is this too real? No, no. Well, what are you going to do? Well, I thought, well, let me go play a game. Got this boss up. Makes you want to just stand outside and go, come here, auditorium. Go tell your mother I did it. Give your brain a distraction. Find something that you enjoy, whether it's zoning out, you know, binge watching on Netflix or something. Catch up with some episodes. Start something. Give your brain a distraction. You have to snap yourself out of that frustrating cycle. If not, you're just going to go on down the road, down the hallway, and something else is going to frustrate you. Huh? I might send my Pekingese to your house. Let me go on to number two. Is this helping you? Now, when I say number two, I'm talking about number two on my paper, not number two on the dollar. Number two, minimize what was highlighted. You'll begin to dwell on everything. Insurance, the hospital, having to stay in the emergency room for 11 hours. 11 hours, people. Do you know that I need food? These chairs are uncomfortable. Who made these chairs? Satan? Can anybody relate to what I'm saying? Scott White, S&W, does not mean Scott White, it means sit and wait. Emergency room, 11 hours. What? Emergency room, 11 hours. For some reason, those two don't mix. You can't have 11 hours and emergency room in the same sentence. We were in the emergency room for 11 hours. Are you getting any of this? And so what do you got to do? Well, you got to minimize what the enemy's highlighting. Have to sit there and call these people. Karen's not feeling well. She's arguing with the people on the phone with the insurance. You want to get that Stone Cold Steve Austin neck roll thing going on. Huh? You want to do the rock, you know, what's your name, jabroni? I don't care what your name is. You go to Walmart. I'm here for some food. Why? Because your brain is in this cycle. You can't get out of it. Are you getting this? You want to order a hamburger. You get yourself a hamburger. You take a bite. Who put the pickles in the burger? Give me that employee, the one with the zits that's not even 20 years old. I want to have a talk with you. Do you not realize I've been on this planet for 52 years and I do not want pickles on my burger? Why did you put pickles on my burger? Is this too much for anybody? Yes, sir. You got to take that highlighter out of his hand. Because you're gonna look at everything. Okay? 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 17. These hard times are small potatoes compared to the coming good times, the lavish celebration prepared for us. So here's what I thought I'd do. Okay, well, these things that I've just experienced are frustrating. I'm just going to do my best Irish voice, and from now on, I'm just going to tell the devil, oh, that's just smart potatoes. Do I want to be frustrated? Oh, yes. My flesh loves it. Isn't right? No. So what do I got to do? Well, I got to change my confession. Yeah. Oh, it's just smart potatoes. What about this? Oh, it's just small potatoes. Well, you've got a lot of potatoes now. What you gonna do? Make salad. Is anybody getting anything out of it? You have to minimize what the enemy has highlighted. You gotta look at it. It's just small potatoes. Why? Because there's an elaborate celebration. God, ha! Oh, let me get out the hanky. God, ha! Oh, he's about to do something. God's on the throne. He didn't leave me alone. Ah, nice, hunter. Woo! So what are you talking about? It's just smart potatoes. That's all it is. Number three. Here's the third thing the Lord has shown me. Forgive yourself.
Amen.
God has. I'm thinking about, I can't believe I used my mouth like that. My God. It was like a machine gun. Baka, 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 baka. You know who are notorious for this? Please don't take this wrong. It's Spanish women when they get mad. Because, like, you know, different folks do different ways, but Spanish women, when they get upset, they pull in the whole family, and when they're talking, it's like a machine. Come here, mijo. Did you see what your papa did? Yeah, come here. Baka, 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 baka. You can just slow motion. Just see them verbal bullets. Wow, that's an anointing. But you have to forgive yourself, because you're going to do stupid things. Well, not you, I did. You're going to do things you knew better.
Yeah.
And so the devil's going to go, what you going to do now, holy man? Gotcha. And that makes you more mad. Now I'm even more frustrated.
Yeah.
Let's go outside and kill some birds. And you have to forgive yourself. Let me show you the most beautiful verse, one of the most beautiful verses in the Bible. Psalms 103. Help me, Lord. Help me.
Hallelujah.
He does not punish us for all of our sins. He does. He does not deal harshly with us as we deserve.
Thank you, Pat.
For this is unfailing, for his unfailing love towards those who fear him, as great as the heights of the heavens above the earth. He has remembered our sins. He has he's removed our sins. I'm sorry. Can I just wipe this off my eye, man? That's just a powerful verse.
Amen.
He has removed our sins as far as the east is from the west. The Lord is like a father to his children, tender and compassionate to those who fear him. For he knows how weak we are, and he remembers that we are only dust.
Amen.
Wow. So I came to church Wednesday night, and I'm just all on myself. I mean, you know what I'm talking about. Amen. You don't need a devil, you've now become your worst enemy. And then Miss Elder Santos comes up and gives me a word from the Lord. And I bawled like a baby. It was such a relief. Right on the money. Right on the money. Because I had entered that self-condemnation mode. You're a failure at this, you're a failure at that. You can't do anything about this. You're at the mercy of your circumstances. People are this, and this situation's that, and what about this, and what about that, it was just a load. And then I get a word from the Lord. Whoo! I pray that each and every one of you will always obey, and God prompts you to give someone a word, because you don't know how it could change them. One word from God can change you overnight. So, God has forgiven us. Now, we want to punish ourselves because of our behaviors or attitudes. I don't know about you. When I get an attitude, I'm a professional. I'm not a rookie attitude getter. I'm a professional. How many professionals do we have here? Yeah, some of y'all holy people just sitting there. Oh, I don't know what you're talking about. I'm a professional. Matter of fact, the college called me back to teach classes so others can be professional. But I found out that God loves me, so I've got to forgive myself.
Amen.
He removes it from the east to the west. I had to go to the doctor because of my holy foot, because I'm a holy man. The doctor said, blah, 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 blah. I said, well, I don't know. I've got a bad attitude. That's my main concern. Not losing the foot was my bad attitude. And Karen's just a trooper. Yeah, just got to stroke him every now and then. The bear eventually calmed down. Just get my hamburger with no pickles, he'll be all right. Am I talking to anybody? Number four, stop trying to control everything. Man, when you're frustrated, I call it the Solomon complex. Can I be real? When you're frustrated, everybody around you becomes a moron. Don't you know how to do this? Don't you not? What were you thinking? How did you get past sixth grade? Everybody in traffic is an idiot. Everybody at the store frustrates you. Huh? The store manager frustrates you. I have to stand in line. Why? Blame it on the management. Somebody didn't schedule enough checkers. Didn't they know I was coming? They should have had the memo. But no, because some moron doesn't know how to schedule more checkers so that when I come into the store, I can just go through. But nay, 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 not today. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Proverbs, Shibaba. Chapter 3, verse 5. Is anybody learning? Is anybody burning? Yeah. All right. Proverbs 3, 5. Are you there? Did I skip one? I'm on number 4, right? Okay. Trust God from the bottom of your heart. And don't try to figure out everything on your own. Well, I don't like that verse. Why? Because I'm frustrated. I've tried talking to you. We know that didn't work. And yet I'm talking to him, complaining to him that he's not listening to me. But I'm talking to him, thinking he doesn't hear me, but I'm talking to him. Which one of us now is the ding dong? I'm talking to the one that I don't think is listening to me, and he's listening to me and answering me, but he's not talking to me. You know what I'm really saying? Nope, you're not telling me what I want to hear. Yes, you're absolutely right. Everybody else around you is a moron. They should know better than to serve you pickles on your hamburgers. They didn't get the memo. I'm sorry, I created the planet that way. But here it says, trust God. Trust God in everything. I learned that trying to control things, okay, is evidence that you still don't trust God in all your doings. I thought I trusted you. Not in this situation, you didn't. I thought I trusted you. Well, not this one. Didn't I tell you all things were going to turn out right? Yeah, but you didn't tell me it was going to be a bumpy ride on this one. I wasn't expecting the bumpy ride. You didn't say buckle up. But doesn't the law say buckle up? Yeah, but I was waiting for you to say buckle up. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Because we can reason a good argument with God. And so that frustration is going on. And so, you know, the Lord was just saying, hey, you know what? You still have some trust issues. Stop trying to take control of everything. I'll go ahead and heal your wife. I'll go ahead and take care of the insurance. I'll make the dogs quit doing what they've been doing, okay? You'll go through this foot thing. You'll come out okay once again, okay? People are going to continue to do their best to serve God and so forth and yada, yada, yada. It's going to be okay. I don't like your time frame. Your watch is too slow. Has anybody ever told you that? Am I talking to anybody? No, you just need to trust me. Number 5, find the good in it. Now, the good in it, the insurance backdated stuff. Hallelujah. The bad in it was, why does my wife have to sit there when she's not feeling well, having to argue with people in the government and the insurance company over this stuff? She's not feeling well. So while she's on the phone trying to deal with these people in the most gentle, loving manner, I'm in the background going, rah, 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 rah. And I know she's probably thinking, I wish you would go downstairs into a bomb shelter. Because you can't find the good in it. You know, why can't they do this? Thank God they're here. Are you getting this? You got to find the good in it. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, Message Translation. Summing it all up, friends, I'd say you'll do best by filling your minds and meditating on things, okay, that are true, noble, reputable, okay, authentic, compelling, gracious, The best, not the worst. The beauty, not the ugly, okay? Things to praise, not things to curse. I chose that translation because of the last sentence in there. Things to praise, not things to curse. I was just finding things wrong left and right. Are you getting any of this? You'll do the same thing. Come here, honey, you're breathing. In, out, inhale, exhale. Oh my God, it sounds like a train going through. Where did you learn to breathe? People driving, where did you learn to drive? Did you get your license out of a Cracker Jack box? Huh? You gotta find the good in it. Hey, thank God, thank God, thank God. You need gas in your car. Thank God I got a car. Huh? You know, your home is blah, blah, blah. Thank God I got a home. Are you getting it? Let me move on. Number six, realize it's just a season. When you're going through it, it doesn't feel like a season. Okay? Psalms 105, verse 17, New Living. Then he sent someone to Egypt. This is talking about God sending Joseph to Egypt. Okay, and Joseph being sold into slavery. Then he sent someone to Egypt ahead of them. What was going on? Well, God knew a famine was coming. So he sent a deliverer to save them, but the deliverer didn't ride in on a white horse like he thought he was. It was totally opposite. Joseph, who was sold as a slave, okay, they bruised his feet with fetters and placed his neck in an iron collar until the time came to fulfill his dreams. The Lord tested Joseph's character. Remember, I told you in the beginning of this that these series of frustrations and annoyances and irritations are designed because you're at the breakthrough. You're at the cusp of a breakthrough, or you're on the edge of a blessing. And so the enemy says, no, we're not going to do that. But God says, he'll pass that character test. It's just a character test. How else do you look at it? Oh, it's just small potatoes. What's the devil doing? Small potatoes. It's a character test. I did not have the right character. Now, does that mean I flunked? No. Because like the prodigal son, when he came to his senses, I finally did what I should have done in the beginning. Let me get my Bible out and see what God has to say about this. And a shaft of light came through my study. Oh, yeah, I couldn't have been it. Had I done that in the first place, it would have been a different thing. But because I got the revelation of it, we're moving on to better things. So are you. It's only for a season, okay? Number seven, be consistent. Galatians, you know this verse. Don't be wearying and well-doing, for in due season you shall reap. Be consistent, okay? The enemy wants you to give in and give up and move on and find another one and do this and kill them and just zip up their bag and, you know, whatever. Just stay consistent. No, I'm sticking with the Word. And that's what I chose to do throughout that time. Well, I'm going to still do the Word. Well, you're frustrated. I know, but I'm still going to do the Word. Well, aren't you upset at God? Yes, I am. Does it show? What are you going to do? Well, I'm still going to do the Word. I've learned better. Okay? Number eight, fellowship. Fellowship with folks. I don't want to fellowship with folks. Romans chapter 15, verse 32, Message Translation. Then, God willing, this is the Apostle Paul writing, I'll be on my way to you with light and eager heart, looking forward to being refreshed by your company. When you're going through some frustration, the enemy wants to isolate you. And I felt that. I walked into that symphony hall. It was called Saints Hall. I got the center seat. Spotlight came on me. The devil began to sing his song of woe.
on everything that was going wrong. And then the whole orchestra of violins kicked in for me. That's a song I can relate to.
Am I talking to you guys? Huh? So what do you got to do? You got to fellowship. You got to find someone to fellowship. Someone, hey, we need to break this cycle. You know, while Pastor Karen was going through this, some of the times I said, hey, let's go garage selling and flea market. Why? Because I know that brings joy to her. So we scrounged up some change. Let's get in the car. Oh, yeah. All of a sudden, she was like Lazarus coming out of the tomb. Be your Pentecostal. Let him, that's mine, in the name of Jesus. Honey, give me some change. Take an authority. Give me some change. Are you getting it? What we do, we fellowship. Now, some couples, when they go through stuff, they just, you know, take shots at one another. You're a fuck, you're a moron, you're an idiot, you're a moron. Your mama's mama, the horse you rode in on, the donkey you rode. And they banter at one another. Get some fellowship. Get out there, do something. Be refreshed. Number 9, give it time.
Thank you, Pat.
Romans chapter 8. Is this too transparent?
No.
Okay. Now if you try to find another church because you found out Pastor had some human traits, I don't blame you. Because we're all aliens anyways. Romans says we're not of this world. I don't know what you're talking about. Romans 8:28, New Living. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to His purpose for them. Now, if you're not careful, you can use sarcasm on scriptures. Well, that's good for them, but what about me? Well, tithing works for them, what about me? Well, God healed them, what about us? Huh? How come they get blessed? I've been at this thing for 20 years. Can't you see I'm a happy Christian? Am I talking to you? Can I give you one more? Don't quit. Number 10 is don't quit.
Amen.
In Proverbs chapter 24, verse 10. Can I be honest with you? I hate this scripture. I loathe this scripture. Because when I read this scripture, it sounds like God is saying, you are such a wimp. Proverbs 24:10. I probably told you too much just now, didn't I? If thou faint in the day of adversity, thy strength is small. You mean the day of adversity. When you're going through some stuff, you quit? You're not as strong as you thought you were, dude. Or dudette. Let me give you the translation that you're going to love this verse. I hope the Holy Spirit never speaks it to you. Proverbs 24:10, Message Translation. If you fall to pieces in a crisis, there wasn't much to you in the first place. Remember the Spanish woman cussing out her husband? Baka, baka, baka. That's how that hit me. Just bullets. You fall to pieces.
I'm gonna get out there and I'm gonna get in and I'm gonna and I should be in there.
They're not much to you anyway. What? Well, the Bible says in the book of Luke, if you can control your own soul, you control the whole city. If you fall to pieces during a crisis, what does that mean? Well, you're not as mature as you thought you were. And that's not tongues, that's whining.
Yeah.
Does anybody see why I hate this scripture? Oh, you want to fall apart? Let me remind you what I said about that. You're just so funny. So that's what I've been through. That's the lessons I've learned. We still got a little ways to go.
But he promised us it's going to be okay.
Genesis 50:20, what the devil intended for evil, God will turn for good.
Amen.
The day that Pastor Karen was supposed to meet the warden for her to go back into the prison was the day we had to go to the emergency room. Now, I don't know about you, but the impact of her ministry to those ladies out there in prison, with the team who helped serve in the Bible college is doing, is phenomenal. And so what the devil decided to do, I don't want you back in my playground. I've got these women bound. I've got them playing their games. I don't want you coming to my playground, setting them free. I'm tired of your stuff. Push. Now, how else do you get to a woman? Well, you mess with her kids or you mess with her husband. Now, here's the funny part. This is so hypocritical of me. I'm just sitting growling in the house. Rah, 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 rah. Come here, dog. Watch. Rah, rah, rah. Clean your butt. And as soon as I would ask him, I'm rah, 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 rah.
Honey, are you okay? Can I get you something?
Rah, 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 rah. Can I make you some soup? Is that not true? Can I get you something to drink? Back and forth, back and forth. She must have thought she was married to Jeff Lynn. What happened to that holy man? I know your foot's holy, but you don't sound nothing like him. Are you getting any of this? What does that mean? Well, she was the day we had to go to the emergency room. We were supposed to go see the warden to get back into prison in order to start that over again. And the devil said, can I be blunt? Oh, hell no. Now, I don't know about you. When something's going on with my wife, I drop everything. I taught you how to go to Jesus. Now it's my turn to take care of her. Are you getting any of this? But you're the pastor. Well, let me pull you nook. Here's some fresh diapers. Learn to pull. Do your own pull-ups. Are you getting it? Instead of dealing with trivial, petty things, okay? Because my true ministry is to God, number one, my wife, number two, family, and then church. Now, most pastors, they'll tell you, well, it's the church. No, then this is his church. I'm just an under-shepherd. And so my primary thing is to take care of my wife. Now, so how do you get to me? You mess with my wife. And so that's what the enemy tried to do. But I know, right now, he's causing us to triumph in all things. This is going to turn out for our good. But this frustration lesson, please be smart enough to learn from me so you don't have to go through it. Because I don't want you to have to buy Pekingese dogs in order to experience that yourself. Did you learn anything today? Give a little hand clap if you did. If you're going through something and you can relate to what I'm saying and you need prayer, I'd like for you to stand where you're at. I want you to stand where you're at. And we all go through. Well, I thought the money was going to be there. Well, I thought this was going to happen. And now they're saying this, and it's gotten worse. And I just, you know, and I thought and hit the head and the enemy's trying to frustrate me. And you just, if one more person says something, you just want to pinch their head off. And the enemy has got you bound in this vicious cycle inside your mind where you just can't see past anything else. I want you to stand. Now, those of you that are sitting by someone who's standing, I want you to get up and I want you to go and put your hand on either their shoulder or their elbow and you're going to go pray for them. Now, this is the altar call. Pastor John, I want you to give me a word. I just gave you a word.